Okay, brothers and sisters, we have with us our esteemed Sheikh and our teacher, Sheikh Muhammad Salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and reward him. Sheikh Muhammad Salah, for those who don't know, regularly appears on Huda TV, and he regularly does the Ask Huda show, where he takes questions and answers, mashallah. And he's also a religious advisor on Huda TV as well, mashallah. Which is, just giving a very short introduction. But the Sheikh has done many things, mashallah, and Allah ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from him and place it in his scale of good deeds. The topic today is entitled A Party in Paradise and a Party in Hell. So would the Sheikh start, Jazakallah khair, may Allah reward him.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. We praise you to Allah alone, we will praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the very beginning, I'd like to tell you that you guys, I envy you for the sake of Allah. You have such a beautiful imam with a great recitation. I definitely, most definitely enjoyed the recitation. Who did it?
I did it.
Yeah, very enjoyable, right? What surah was it? What surah? Surah Hud. And I do believe that the Imam carefully chose the ayat to suit the topic that we're talking about today. It was not just a coincidence. So he was, mashallah, successful both in the recitation and in his choice. A party in hell and a party in heaven. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the dwellers of heaven. Ameen. 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 The ayah which specifically speak about the two parties, Ahlul Jannah or Ahlul Nar, is mentioned in Surah Ash-Shura. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لِتُنذِرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا وَتُنذِرَ يَوْمَ الْجَمْعِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ في السعير. A party in Jannah and a party in the blazing fire. ولو شاء الله لجعلهم أمة واحدة ولكن يدخل من يشاء في رحمته والظالمون ما لهم من ولي ولا نصير. This division, the two parties, which will have no third, definitely, is by the end of life, on the day of resurrection, when people will be redistributed according to their fate. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, amongst His names, is Al-Adl, the most just. He was not born to punish nor hold accountable any person or any nation without sending and appointing a messenger to them. Right? وَإِن مِّنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. And there is not a single nation, but Allah appointed a warner to them. A messenger from among themselves who spoke their mother tongue to deliver Allah's message to them. And similarly, thus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Qur'anan Arabiyya لِتُنذَرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى. أُمَّ الْقُرَى is one of the names of Mecca Urbaka, the mother of all the villages and the cities, the greatest city ever, Mecca. وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا Not only Umm al-Qura or the peninsula alone, but his message, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is definitely a universal message. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ Surah Al-Anbiya. And we have not sent you, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but as a mercy for Al-Alameen means what? بس قل humanity ها قل أوحي إلي أنه استمع نفر من الجن right ولقد ذرأنا لجهنم كثيرا من ال right so even the fire of hell a group of the ins and a group of the jinn would be doomed to either both to either one of them similarly al ins طيب was his mercy صلى الله عليه وسلم limited to الجن والإنس No, that's not fair. It was not. What about the hadith? فَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَ And the she-camel or the camel which went to complain to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, etc. Many a hadith. So also to animals, correct. To nature, absolutely. Then وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ Means, we have not sent you but as mercy for everything that exists. صلى الله عليه وسلم By the end of Surah Ash-Shura the same chapter which has the two verses 7 and 8 which I just recited earlier Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again reiterate what he said before by saying وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانُ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا وَإِنْ إنك لتهدي إلى صراط مستقيم صراط الله الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض ألا إلى الله تصير الأمور And thus we sent unto you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the wahy from us, the Quran. ما كنت تدري ما الكتاب ولا الإيمان You weren't aware of the Qur'an or faith or belief before that. We made the Qur'an nuran, light. نهدي به من نشاء من عبادنا. To guide the way, whomsoever we are pleased with, whomsoever we will, of our servants. And most certainly, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you do guide people to the straight path. The straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by the end أَلَا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَصِيرُ الْأُمُورِ So when you look at the number 7 and 8 then the last two ayat number 52 and 53 we realize the main purpose and the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which contains two things the glad tidings and the inzar or the warning. The inzar and the warning. And there is always balance in the Qur'an between the bishara and the nidhar. The glad tidings and the warning. But the most frequently warning that is mentioned in the Qur'an, warning against what? وَتُنذِرَ يَوْمَ الْجَمْعِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ To warn people, against the day of gathering, the day of resurrection, which definitely will take place. All the disbelievers at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and at every single time with different nations and different prophets, they mock at their prophets. And they say, Mata as-sa'a? When is the day of judgment? They're not asking to find out when will it take place. No, they're mocking at the prophets. At the warning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying, just bring it on. If there will be a day of judgment, an accountability and reckoning, just bring it on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتُنذِرَ يَوْمَ الْجَمْعِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. No doubt, the day will come to pass. The day will take place, and people from the time of Adam alayhi salam to the very end will be resurrected, then there will be further redistribution. Further redistribution. We noticed that I screened all the books of Sunnah and I found an amazing thing. Very oftenly the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he wanted to adjure his companions or urge us to do or not to do anything, he would begin by saying, what? مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Can you call any hadith which begins with, let whosoever believes in Allah in the last day, do or do not do? Huh? Give me one hadith. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. This is the last statement of the hadith, but this is true in the Muwatta of Imam Malik. Huh? Who can quote the hadith? من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم جاره ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم ضيفه ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. Let whosoever believes in Allah and in the last day. So the belief of Allah and the belief in the last day that will definitely come to happen are inseparable from each other. The problem with non-Muslims, they are absent-minded when it comes to belief in the last day. Even those who claim to be monotheistic, the people of Ahlul Kitab, when they bury somebody, they say that, rest in peace. And how do you know? How do you know that he's resting or in peace? How do you know? Right? The problem with those who do not believe properly in Allah and in the last day, in order to allow for themselves to do whatever they wish, whatever they desire, they say, well, God sacrificed his son for our sins. So basically, whatever you do, as long as you believe in Jesus, for instance, then your sins will be forgiven automatically. And you will be pardoned. The Jews said the same thing. وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَا النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودًا. They said, even if God were to punish us, we'd only spend 7 days in fire. Then we'll be apt. Because they said, نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاءُهُ. We are the chosen children of God and His most beloved. While we have in our deen a combination of balance, the person, every Muslim, is required to have the balance of hope and fear. Hope and fear. Uthman ibn Maz'un, radiyallahu anhu, one of the great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was one of the muhajireen. He was hosted in the house of Ummul Ala. When he was dying, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to visit him. And when he died, they washed his body, they wrapped him in the coffin. And the Prophet ﷺ placed a kiss on his face and he shed tears. The Prophet ﷺ cried for the death of Uthman ibn Maz'un. Their Ummul Ala, a great lady companion, radiyallahu anha, said, شهادتي عليك أن الله قد رحمك أو غفر لك. I bear witness that you're a winner and Allah has forgiven you your sins and Allah have mercy on you. I bear witness that you are one of the dwellers of heaven. You see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was just doing what? Kissing him and shedding tears. Right? All of a sudden the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very disturbed with the statement of Ummul Ala. He looked at her and he said, وَمَا يُدْرِيكِ. And how do you know that Allah has forgiven him his sins? How do you know that he's one of the rulers of heaven? What makes you so sure that he's from Ahlul Jannah? Look at the answer of Umm al-Ala. She's seen this companion. She said, Ya Rasulullah, فمن? If Allah is not going to admit Uthman ibn Maz'un to heaven, so then who will go to heaven? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Umm al-Ala, by Allah, I myself, I am the messenger of Allah, and I don't know what's going to happen to me. Umm al-Ala was scared, and she said, by Allah, I would never, ever admire anybody after that. Every person is required to keep balance between hope to enter al-Jannah and fear that his deeds might be rejected. Because if deeds are rejected, then the person will be doomed to fire, wal-iyadu billah. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, used to say, by Allah, if I know that Allah has accepted from me one single sajda, then I would love to die right now. They said, why? He said, because Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Verily, Allah only accepts the deeds of the righteous ones. Al-Muttaqeen. So if Allah accepted from me one sajda, that means I fit in. I'm one of Al-Muttaqeen. Then I don't care if I die right now. I don't know whether I am one of them or not. Whether Allah have accepted from me my good deeds or rejected them. This balance between hope and fear keeps a person always on the straight path. But people who have a problem believing in يوم الجمع, they like to adorn to themselves their own doings, whether good or bad. They always speak about God is all forgiving. True, isn't He? He is. But He's also شديد العقاب. Right? There is always balance in the Quran between mercy and punishment, forgiveness and punishment. The same number of times Allah spoke about Al-Jannah, He also mentioned An-Nar equal to that in the same number of times. وَتُنذِرَ يَوْمَ الْجَمْعِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, and to warn people against the day of gathering. There is no doubt in it. Another hadith, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلَا يَسْقِ مَاءُهُ زَرْعَ غَيْرِهِ. If you truly believe in Allah, and in the last day, يعني you believe that there will be a day and you will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for reckoning, then let not that person يَسْقِ مَاءُهُ زَرْعَ غَيْرِهِ. الماء is referring to the sexual discharge. يعني let him not have an intimate relationship or a sexual relation with a woman who's not lawful to him. فَلَا يَسْقِ مَاءُهُ زَرْعَ غَيْرِهِ. This is a metaphor. Let him not water the vegetations of somebody else. Because this woman is not lawful to you, like a fertile soil, but it is for somebody else. So do not have an illegitimate or an illicit relationship with another woman. من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر. In another hadith, let him not sit on a table where people are drinking. When a person has a confusion or a doubt. Sheikh, I'm not drinking myself. I have to attend a business meeting or a circle meeting where everybody is drinking. Or I have to host the clients because I'm an HR. I have to host the clients and sometimes I have to pay for their alcohol. That's my job in the company. Is this halal or haram? Here is the proof. من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فلا يجلس على مائدة تدار عليها الخمر, and so on and so forth. Whenever the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in many occasions wanted to remind us or encourage us to do something or warn us again is doing something, he would remind us, do you believe in Allah? Yeah. Do you believe in اليوم الآخر? Yeah. Then listen carefully. You see the difference? So what happens? فريق في الجنة وفريق في السعير. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَهُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had willed, He would have made all mankind one ummah. one united nation, which means he would have made them all believers, like al-malaika يعني. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create us for this purpose. He created us and he provided us with the free will to be distinct from any other creation. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. He created death and life. Do you know why he mentioned death before life? Who knows? The ayah of Surah Al-Mulk, تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق, the one who created, not life and death, he said, خلق الموت والحياة. Created death, the life, in order to test you, which one of you is best in deeds, or have better deeds. Why did he begin? By al-maut, by death. Who knows? Fine. I'm supposed to have another lecture with you. That's a homework. Go home and open the books of Tafaseer or Google it and try to find out. Because I believe if I provide you with the answer that easy, it will evaporate as soon as we leave the lecture. So try to do your homework and figure out why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned death before life. That he created death and life. Fine. In order to test us, which one of us will be better in deeds? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So he says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَهُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. But Allah doesn't want us to be like al-malaika, just obedient without a choice. He gave us the free will. وَلَكِنْ يُدْخِلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ فِي رَحْمَتِهِ. But he admits whomever he wills in his mercy. The Hidayah. Hidayah to Tawfiq. In Surah Hud, one of the prophets says, وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَإِلَيْهِ أُنِيبُ. My success is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one who will be rightly guided, not because he's intelligent, or when he read the Quran, he figured out on his own that that is the book and that is the truth. Rather, it is by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the help of Allah that he chose this person to be rightly guided. That's why the greatest blessing ever after life is to be rightly guided. Alhamdulillahi ala ni'matil Islam wa kafa biha ni'ma. وَالظَّالِمُونَ مَا لَهُمْ مِنْ وَلِيٍّ وَلَا نَصِيرٍ. And as far as the other party, الظَّالِمُونَ, the wrongdoers who wrong themselves, they shall have no wali protector, no supporter, no nasir on the day of judgment. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that after he sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he delivered the message, people were divided. Some accepted his message and some rejected it. And based on that, and after everybody will be gathered all together, لِيَوْمِ الْجَمْعِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, for the day of resurrection and gathering, فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ. There will be a group or a party who will end up in Al-Jannah, may Allah make us amongst them, and a party will end up in fire, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. Most of people will end up in fire. It will be said to Adam, Allah will tell Adam on the day of judgment, Ya Adam, ibath ba'th an-nar. Yalla, take out of your offspring those who are going to hell. So Adam alayhi salam will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are they? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, out of every 1,999. That should make us feel frightened and should make us feel very lucky and cheer. Why? Because to be chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come and attend the prayer, to be rightly guided first, then to come and attend the prayer, to follow the manhaj of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, this is the greatest privilege. Because these divisions, brothers and sisters, are not limited to being a Muslim or a non-Muslim. but within the Ummah itself, there are divisions. And those divisions are not ordinary divisions such as we have our Islamic center and they have their Islamic center. No, we're talking about divisions which the Prophet ﷺ has said in the hadith, which is collected by Al-Hakim and others, that the Jews were divided into 71 sects. Christians were divided into 72 sects. Everybody knows this hadith. And my ummah will be divided into 73 sects. All of them are in fire, except for one. So the vast majority of those who say we are Muslims, 72 sects. I'm talking about the vast majority of the groups. But as far as number, it is different. Because look at the number of Qadianis, or Baha'is, Ahmadis, Ismailis, Aghakhanis, compared to the mainstream, to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. It's nothing. So the Prophet ﷺ said, all of them fil nar, except for one. Because the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim were very curious and were very keen to be among the saved party, even though the Prophet ﷺ was living with them, they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, which group that will be saved? The Prophet ﷺ answered, as you all know, هُمْ مَنْ عَلَى مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمِ وَأَصْحَابِي. It will be the group, those who will be following whatever I'm following today and my companions. So this group does not have to be a group. It could be an individual. It could be one person. As long as he fulfills the conditions. He's following strictly the guidance of the Prophet ﷺ. He does not have a problem with the rest of articles of Iman. He does not misinterpret the ayat of the Quran, nor reject the ayat of the Quran, or any of them, or the sound ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He does not have a problem with the companions whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praise and admire, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delivered the glad tidings to them that they will be from amongst Ahlul Jannah. So that is the straight path. And this is the mainstream of this ummah, and the party which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that is the only party which will be saved. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. A very important fact that was mentioned several times in the Quran. In Surah Hud, in ayah number 118 and 119, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ وَلِذَلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. The ayat say, if Allah willed, He would have made all mankind one ummah, believers, like al-malaika. But this is not the case. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ. They will be always different. Different parties, different groups, different religions, different faith. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ. Except for those whom Allah will cover with His mercy. Will be one single ummah, regardless. One in India, one in Iraq, one in Iran, one in the States, one here and one there. They share and maintain the same belief. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ. وَلِذَٰلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. He created them for this season, to test them and verify their iman. وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. So that applies to al-ins and to al-jinn. The fire of hell will be filled by both human beings and the disbelievers of the jinn, the disbelievers of al-ins and the disbelievers of al-jinn. Also in Surah Yunus, in ayah number 99, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. But this is not His will. His will was to give us the free will, and everybody choose on their own. In the hadith,
Let me first quote the ayat which Sheikh Tamer was reading in Salatul Maghrib. Not all of them, but I will reflect on the ayat which he recited in the first rak'ah, particularly the ayat which are talking about the two parties. فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ and الْأَشْقِيَاء and السُعَدَاء. In which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَخْذُ رَبِّكَ إِذَا أَخَذَ الْقُرَى وَهِيَ ظَالِمَةٌ إِنَّ أَخْذَهُ أَلِيمٌ شَدِيدٌ. This ayah is talking as a comment on the different ways of punishing the disbelievers. He talked about other nations, the people of Shu'aib, the people of Musa alayhi salam, and how they were punished. So he said, and thus similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seizes the disbelievers when they disobey. إِنَّ أَخْذَهُ أَلِيمٌ شَدِيدٌ. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ in these stories, لَآيَةٌ رَصَيْنٌ لِمَنْ خَافَ عَذَابَ الْآخِرَةِ for those who fear the torment of the hereafter. ذَلِكَ يَوْمٌ مَجْمُوعٌ لَهُ النَّاسُ وَذَلِكَ يَوْمٌ مَشْهُودٌ. That is the day of judgment, where people will be gathered for that day particularly. وَذَلِكَ يَوْمٌ مَشْهُودٌ. So the first process is the gathering. Then the redistribution. Redistributing the two parties. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَوْمَ يَأْتِي when that day shall come to pass, what will happen? لا تكلم نفس إلا بإذنه فمنهم شقي وسعيد. On that day, no one would dare to open his mouth or utter a word except by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not even the angels or the prophets. Then people will be divided into two parties, شقي وسعيد. شقي means rich, not unblessed. وسعيد, the happy and the blessed party. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. Also in Surah Al-A'raf, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about Ahlul Jannah and Ahlul Nar and said, وَبَيْنَهُمَا حِجَابُ وَعَلَى الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالٌ يَعْرِفُونَ كُلًّا بِسِيمَاهُمْ. He spoke about by the end the fate of Ahlul A'raf, that they will end up in Al-Jannah. يعني brothers and sisters, يوم القيامة there will be only two destinations, either Jannah or Nar. There is nothing in between. No people will be left without reckoning. No people will be left abandoned in between Al-Jannah or Al-Nar. Then there is a further classification in Surah Al-Waqi'ah and other surahs pertaining the ranks of Ahlul Jannah. السابقون, أصحاب اليمين, right? But Ahlul Nar is one party and Ahlul Jannah is another party. فَمِنْهُمْ شَقِيٌ وَسَعِيدٌ. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ شَقُوا as for those who will be rich. فَفِي النَّارِ لَهُمْ فِيهَا زَفِيرٌ وَشَهِيقٌ. They will be in fire وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ لَهُمْ فِيهَا زَفِيرٌ وَشَهِيقٌ. You know the braying of a donkey? This will, that will be their cry as they're falling in النار وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. The braying of a donkey, it begins very high and out loud, then he faints. That is the zafir wa shahiq of ahlul nar wal a'udhu billah. Khalidina fiha ma damat as-samawati wal ardu illa ma sha'a rabbuk. How long will they stay in fire wal a'udhu billah? How long? Is it like what the Yahud say? Ayyaman ma'duda, a few days, 7 days or so? La. Khalidina fiha, they shall reside therein eternally, forever, as long as the heavens and the earth endure, except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills otherwise. Then, وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ سُعِدُوا فَفِي الْجَنَّةِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا مَا دَامَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ رَبُّكَ عَطَاءً غَيْرَ مَجْذُوذٍ. As for those who will be blessed, the happy party, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them, will they will in Al-Jannah eternally. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا مَا دَامَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. In the hadith, في الصحيحين البخاري ومسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us that there was a very interesting debate and an argument between Al-Jannah wa-Nar. Between Al-Jannah wa-Nar. اختصمت الجنة والنار, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said. فقالت الجنة ما لي لا يدخلني إلا ضعفة الناس وسقطهم. What is the matter? My dwellers are the weak and the oppressed ones. وقالت النار أوثرت بالمتكبرين والمتجبرين. My people are the arrogant ones, the big shots. This is al-Jannah and this is al-Nar. فقال الله عز وجل للجنة, so Allah سبحانه وتعالى addressed al-Jannah by saying, أنت رحمتي أرحم بك من أشاء. You are my mercy, which I cover with whomever I will. وقال للنار, and he said to the fire of hell, أنت عذابي أنتقم بك ممن أشاء. You are my punishment, I punish with you whomever I will. ولكل واحدة منكما ملؤها. For each one of you, don't worry, you will have people to fill you up. يرحمكم الله. And so on. There is another hadith in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when Allah سبحانه وتعالى created الجنة and النار, He sent Jibreel عليه السلام to check them both out. So Jibreel paid a visit to Al-Jannah. And when he returned to Allah to give him the report about his visit, he said, how do you like Al-Jannah? His وَحِزَّتِكَ لَا يَسْمَعُ بِهَا أَحَدٌ إِلَّا دَخَلَهَا. I swear by your honor and majesty, for anyone who would hear about what you have prepared for the dwellers of Al-Jannah, certainly they all have to enter it. فِيهَا مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. Right? So he went to An-Nar and he came with the following feedback. He said, وَعِزَّتِكَ مَا يَسْمَعُ بِهَا أَحَدٌ أَبَدًا وَيَدْخُلُهَا. I swear, no one would ever hear about its punishment and severe torment and will enter it. They have to take precautions that if they are wise. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made some modifications on both Al-Jannah and An-Nar. He surrounded Al-Jannah with what? Hardship and difficulties. And he surrounded An-Nar with desires and lust. Then he ordered Jibreel alayhi salam to go back and take a look at it. Jibreel alayhi salam returned with this feedback about Al-Jannah. He said, I swear I'm afraid that no one will make it. And about An-Nar, he said, I swear by your honor and majesty, I'm afraid that no one will be saved from it. أما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى. سورة النزعات. فأما من طغى وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى. وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى. As for him who transgresses and obeys his hawa, are you gonna drink? Drink. You don't have a girlfriend? Why not? As long as it is not illegal, as long as you will not be caught and punished by law, then do it. You're free to do as you wish. Such person, طغى وآثر الحياة الدنيا, he's abhorred. His mother will be النار والعياذ بالله. وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى. But as for him who restrains himself from what he desires, because he fears standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he knows that he has to answer for everything, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Then Al-Jannah will be his abode and eternal residence, inshaAllah Azza Jal. Look at that. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, by Allah, لَالْجَنَّةُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ أَحَدِكُمْ مِنْ شِرَاكِ نَعْلِهِ. What does it mean? Who knows? Nah. Every time we come to the masjid and we're leaving, those who have their shoes with shoelace, they have to tie their shoelace, right?
Does it burden you to lean over in order to tie your shoelace? No. Right? The Prophet ﷺ says that heaven is nearer to you than your own shoelace. But wait a minute. وَالنَّارُ مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ And the fire of hell is likewise. Al-Jannah is very near to you. There are a lot of things, a lot of virtues that you can make to enter Al-Jannah. Dhikr, recitation of Quran, just by praying the fard. Praying the fard and offering what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mandated, that is sufficient to take you to Al-Jannah. The hadith of the Badwi, who came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it's a sound hadith. Collected by Imam Bukhari, he said, Ya Rasulullah, tell me, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordain on me? What do I have to do? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 5 daily prayers. Illa an tatawwa, unless if you want to offer extra. He said, what else? To fast during Ramadan, unless if you want to offer voluntary fasting. Zakah likewise, Hajj likewise. After the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished, this Bedouin said that the Bedouins were blunt, not just where they are. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "والذي بعثك بالحق," I swear by the one who sent you with the truth, "لا أزيد على ذلك." I will never do anything extra. I would only do the fard. Well, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "If you do that, you'll go to Al-Jannah." He said, I swear by Allah, I will not do anything extra. The man turned around and he was leaving. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one narration looked at him and said, أَفْلَحَ وَأَبِيهِ إِنْ صَدَقَ He will be successful indeed if he can just stick to what he said. If he can fulfill his promise. If he can just stick to the fard, he will be successful. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Whoever would like to look at one of the dwellers of Al-Jannah, look at this man. Just for offering the fard? Yes. But the thing is, there is another narration in which the Prophet ﷺ said that when the man said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَا أَزِيدُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَنْقُصُ I will never do anything extra, nor will I decrease. How can you decrease in that? Sometimes we stand up in the prayer, We pray and we finish the prayer and we were totally absent-minded. There was no khushu', there was no concentration. So nothing out of this prayer counts. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sometimes one of us will stand up in prayer and he would leave the prayer, he would only have a fit. 1/10, 1/9, 1/8, 1/7, 1/6, 1/5, 1/4, 1/3. Based upon your khushu' and tranquility in the salah. Not because you did the jumping jacks, the physical part of it, that the salah is recorded as a salah. La. We stand up in the prayer and each and everyone is different from others. Everyone with the amount of his khushu' and concentration. So if one can maintain that, then he's successful. أَفْلَحَ وَأَبِيهِ إِنْ صَدَقْ That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed the nawafil in order to encourage us to catch up and to make up the shortcomings that may take place in the salah, in the zakah, in the sadaqat, in the siyam, and so on. In the sacred hadith, in the hadith al-Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ وَمَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ Nothing can bring myself nearer to me better than fulfilling what I have ordained on him. And my servant will continue to draw closer and closer to me via what? Through what mean? An-nawafil, until I love him. So an-nawafil is the area of competition. But the fard, every Muslim must do. That is the minimum requirement. But the nawafil, this is the area of competition. Go ahead and compete with others, and so on. Quickly, I just want to go through some of the ayat which distinguish between the fate of Ahlul Jannah, Fariqun fil Jannati wa Fariqun fil Sa'ir. Briefly, even without a translation, perhaps inshallah I can go back to those ayat, they're very famous. First of all, in Surah Al-Hashr,
in ayah number 20. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة. أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون. They are not even. Though will they be ever equal or even? Who are they? أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة. The dwellers of fire and the dwellers of al-Jannah, they will not be treated the same. They're entirely different. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Waqi'ah with regards to the food of Ahl al-Jannah, وَفَاكِهَةٍ مِمَّا يَتَخَيَّرُونَ وَلَحْمِ طَيْرٍ مِمَّا يَشْتَهُونَ. They eat the fruits that they desire, and they eat the flesh of the birds which they like. And says also قُطُوفُهَا دَانِيَةٌ كُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا هَنِيئًا بِمَا أَسْلَفْتُمْ فِي الْأَيَّامِ الْخَالِيَةِ in Surah Al-Haqqah. Right? طيب, what about أهل النار والعياد بالله؟ in Surah Al-Ghashiyah, لَيْسَ لَهُمْ طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ ضَرِيعٌ لَا يُسْمِنُ وَلَا يُغْنِي مِنْ جُوعٌ. The food will be ضَرِيعٌ, which is a very awful tree producing very awful fruits that are very bitter and will make them short and will make them thirsty. So when they ask for the water, they will be given al-hamim, the boiling water which contains their pus secretions and their blood. عِصَارَةُ أَهْلِ النَّارِ وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. In addition to شَجَرَةُ الزَّقُّومِ, which is طَعَامُ الْأَثِيمِ كَالْمُهْلِ يَغْلِي فِي الْبُطُونِ كَغَلْيَ الْحَمِيمِ in Surah Al-Dukhan, ayat number 44 and 45. While أهل الجنة إن شاء الله will be given يسقون من رحيق مختوم ختامه مسك وفي ذلك فليتنافس المتنافسون ومزاجه من تسنيم عينا يشرب بها المقربون. Then I would like to pause by the following ayah of Surah المطففين. إن الذين أجرموا كانوا من الذين آمنوا يضحكون وإذا مروا بهم يتغامزون وإذا انقلبوا إلى أهلهم انقلبوا فكهين وإذا رأوهم قالوا إن هؤلاء لضالون وما أرسلوا عليهم حافظين. فاليوم الذين آمنوا من الكفار يضحكون على الأرائك ينظرون هَلْ ثُوِّبَ الْكُفَّارُ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. Beautiful ayah. Describing our current situation. The kuffar, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite Quran, they used to mock at him. They used to mock fun of the tree. They used to make fun of the believers and mock at them, right? And it will be the subject of their joking and laughing at whom? At those foolish believers. As when I saw in one of the newspapers a picture of a Muslim who's praying. You know, in America we pray, I don't know the situation here, we have long extended highways, so whenever we're traveling you just pull over and you pray. So this person was praying and a Coca-Cola truck was passing by. A photographer managed to take a shot of the person while he is prostrating himself in front of the Coke truck. And beneath it, Muslims worship Coca-Cola. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَجْرَمُوا كَانُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَضْحَكُونَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِهِمْ they wink at them, they make fun of them. Soon, إن شاء الله عز وجل, فَالْيَوْمَ on the day, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا the believers who were oppressed, who were harassed and persecuted, on the day of judgment will be reclining on their couches and will be mocking at laughing at the criminals, those whom used to mock at them and laugh at them during this life. And that's why I want to go through the ayat in 1 minute of Surah Al-A'raf. And you know Al-A'raf is taking the name after Al-A'raf, which is an elevated place in between Al-Jannah and Al-Nar. In Christianity, that is recognized as the purgatories. In Islam, وعلى الأعراف رجال يعرفون كلا بسيماهم. The مفسرين differed with regards to the being of those people who will be standing on al-A'raf between al-Jannah and al-Nar. But the ayat explain thoroughly who will be there, who will be those people, and what will be their fate. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 44, وَنَادَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيدِ. أصحاب الجنة, they're the dwellers of al-Jannah, will have a chance not just to look at the dwellers of fire, but also to talk to them. نَادَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ, they will call on them. أَنْ قَدْ وَجَدْنَا مَا وَعَدَنَا رَبُّنَا حَقَّ فَهَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقَّ. We certainly found what Allah has promised us true. What about you? Did you find Allah's promise true? And this is the statement that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to whom? He said it to whom? Who remembers? Huh? Ya jama'ah, did you study seerah? Please, if you did not study seerah, at least read the book of Safi al-Rahman Mubarakafuri, may Allah have mercy on him, the seal nectar. It's just one volume. It comprehends the whole seerah. Every Muslim must learn the biography and the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the least. I cannot imagine a single Muslim does not know the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's one book and very beautiful. Of course, there are bigger books, Zadul Ma'ad, etc. But if you're too busy, at least read Al-Rahiq Al-Maktub. And I may suggest to a native speaker to record that book and make it an audio book that can benefit the ummah on an MP3 or MP4. While driving, he can listen to it going back and forth. And this is how you get to read the books, by listening to it. So if you have some spare time, you can divide the book in several chapters and give each one a chapter and say, please record this for us. And you that you started your media department here in the center, this is something which it's nafa and it's benefit, mutaaddi, will benefit others. Hopefully, inshallah, will benefit those who will do it after their death and until the day of judgment. فَالدَّلُّ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ لَهُ أَجْرُ فَاعِلٍ. Anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed Abu Jahl, Ubay ibn Khalaf, and these guys who were killed, the Meccan chiefs, who were killed during the Battle of Badr. As he did not throw their bodies in the desert for stray dogs to devour them, no. He did not mutilate their bodies or urinate on their bodies, as you've seen in some of the videos, la. A human being. Yes, he was the worst enemy to the ummah. The Prophet said about Abu Jahl, he was the pharaoh of this ummah. Yet, they died, they have to be buried. So he dumped them into the well, and he buried them, and he stood next to the well, and he addressed them. هَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقَّ يَا أَبَا جَهْلٍ يَا أُبَيِّ هَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقَّ, which means, did you find Allah's promise true? So the Sahaba came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, take it easy, they're dead, they cannot hear you. He said, nay, by Allah, they hear me better than you do. And the answer is certainly yes. هَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ حَقَّ. So أَهْلُ النَّارُ will answer saying, قَالُوا نَعَمْ. Certainly. فَأَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ بَيْنَهُمْ أَلَّعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الظَّالِمِينَ. Then in the ayah number 46, وَبَيْنَهُمَا حِجَابٌ, between al-Jannah and al-Nar, there is a barrier. وَعَلَى الْأَعْرَافِ, the elevated place between al-Jannah and al-Nar, those people whose good deeds and bad deeds were even, 50-50. They needed a merciful degree so that they can be transferred to Al-Jannah. But as long as they are in Al-A'raf, they will end up in Al-Jannah, inshallah. وَبَيْنَهُمَا حِجَابٌ وَعَلَى الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالٌ. Those men who will be on Al-A'raf, they recognize أهل الجنة, and they recognize also أهل النار. They have seen the believers going back and forth to the masjid, and they have seen the criminals making fun of them. So what happened? Look at this conversation quickly. نادوا أصحاب الجنة. They will call on أهل الجنة. Say, سلام عليكم. Peace be with you. لم يدخلوها وهم يطمعون. Ahlul A'raf have not made it to Al-Jannah yet, but they're very much eager. They love to go to Al-Jannah. هم يطمعون, they're hoping to enter Al-Jannah. وَإِذَا صُرِفَتْ أَبْصَارُهُمْ تِلْقَاءَ أَصْحَابِ النَّارِ. And when they take a look at the dwellers of fire, قَالُوا رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا مَعَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. They will say, Oh Lord, please, we beg you, do not send us with wrongdoers. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالًا يَعْرِفُونَهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ. Then they will call on أهل النار, whom they recognize in the dunya that they were making fun of the believers. يَعْرِفُونَهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ. Their faces will be darkened. Their eyes will be extremely blue due to the punishment and the severe torment. What will they say to them? قَالُوا مَا أَغْنَى عَنْكُمْ جَمْعُكُمْ وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. What happened to your wealth? What happened to your power? What happened to your possessions? Nothing of that availed you an art. Again, is the torment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَهَٰؤُلَاءِ الَّذِينَ أَقْسَمْتُمْ لَا يَنَالُهُمُ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَةٍ. Are those the people whom you used to swear that they will not make it to heaven? Because we have people like Pat Robertson and those guys who show up on the 700 Club. They accuse us of being disbelievers and that we will never see heaven. So on the day of judgment, Ahlul A'raf will ask them, are those the same people that you said that they will not make it to heaven? And are the disbelievers? أُدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ تَحْزَنُونَ. وَنَادَى أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ أَنْ أَفِيضُوا عَلَيْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ أَوْ مِمَّا رَزَقَكُمُ اللَّهِ. قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَهُمَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. Then Ahlul Nar will have a chance to speak to Ahlul Jannah. What would they say? They will ask for one thing. Give us a sip of water. Give us a sip of water. Ahlul Jannah will say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَهُمَا عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا دِينَهُمْ لَهْوًا وَلَعِبًا وَغَرَّتْهُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. Those who used to take the deen as mockery. And again, يَا إِخْوَانِي, after all what we studied right now, in this 1 hour or so, life is very short and brief. And soon after we die, everybody will figure out his fate. In the hadith, إِذَا مَاتَ الْعَبْدُ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُهُ. Once each and every individual dies, he or she will figure out their fate. We'll know whether they're going to Al-Jannah or Al-Nar. In the lengthy hadith, which describes what will happen to the soul after it departs the body and it goes to heaven, if it was a soul of one of the believers, it will be wrapped in a coffin from heaven and it will be sent back with peace to earth and so on. And the opposite is true with the criminals. Then when the person is in his grave, will appear to him, if he was a believer, a man with a beautiful face, with a great fragrance. Then he will call on him by his best names. He will say, so and so, don't you recognize me? He said, I don't know you. Who are you? He will say, Anna? Huh? Anna Amaluk. I am your deed. Don't you recognize me? Anna Amaluk. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open for him a window in his grave where he can take a look at his seat in heaven. In heaven. So right upon seeing that, this person will say, Rabbi aqim as-sa'a, Rabbi aqim as-sa'a, Ya Rabb, establish the day of judgment right now. Why? Because he knows that he's successful. Like a person who passed the highway school with honor grade and he got several scholarship. He can't wait to go to college. Right? Of course, there is a difference, but this is just an example to illustrate. On the other hand, when the soul of the criminal will be returned to the body, will appear with a dark face and an awful smell, then will call on that person with his worst names, like people used to make fun of him and give him bad names that he hated. He will call him with his worst name. Hey, fat, whatever, potato head, whatever. He will say, yo, say, who are you? You're such a very offensive person. What's this smell? What this ugly face? He will say, don't you recognize me? Of course I don't. I am your deed. I am your deeds indeed. And amaluk. Then a window will be opened for him where he will take a look at his fate. في النار والعياذ بالله. At this he would proclaim saying, رَبِّ لَا تُقِمِ السَّاعَةَ أَبَدًا. My Lord, never, ever establish the day of judgment. So he's been punishing the grape, but he doesn't care. He believes this is much better than seeing what's awaiting him in the farafil wal-iyadu billah. So since this life is short and brief, brothers and sisters, let's seize this opportunity. One simple advice I will give to myself and you before we're dismissed. Do you know that in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whosoever says, Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdih, once, what will happen to him? Huh? Nah. Allahu Akbar. Allah will plant a day palm tree for him in heaven. Okay. Can you hold stop watches and see how many seconds will it take to say slowly with a regular rhythm, Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdih? A fraction of a second. So in 1 second, how many times can you say Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdih? So in 1 minute, how many times can you have, how many day palm trees can you have for yourself planted in heaven? And I understand that if I have a property somewhere, that means I have residency too, right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst Ahlul Jannah. آمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا. اللهم اجعلنا من السعداء أهل الجنة ولا تجعلنا من الأشقياء أهل النار. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وسلام على المرسلين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وجزاكم الله خيرا.